If it's Monday night, oh yes it is, the Wrestling Forum. Hello friends, it's Ridiculously Over Anthony Fleury here with you for another exciting edition of the Wrestling Forum, 24 hours removed from the greatest night of Shakespearean drama these four individuals have ever been a part of. And, well, we got a little more of it tonight. Maybe not as exciting as last night, you know, with Money in the Bank and Game 7 of the NBA Finals, the highest rated NBA game on ABC television ever, if you didn't notice my Facebook post earlier today. So, yeah. Now we move on to the fallout from Money in the Bank, and we start the road to Battleground, and oh boy, this road to Battleground is already a bumpy one. And we still got another month of this to go. So, hence why another night of Shakespearean drama at its finest. But we have to start on a very serious note, like we always do here on the show. Of course, what happened was news briefs came out. WWE Diva Paige was involved in an incident during the Money in the Bank, following Money in the Bank last night in Vegas. She was arrested and booked, but that obviously didn't stop her from, you know, being on the show tonight. And, of course, you know, in addition to that, this past Friday, Jerry the King Lawler, WWE Hall of Famer, indefinitely suspended after a domestic dispute with his young girlfriend in his Memphis home early Friday morning. He's been indefinitely suspended. So that's a couple of the news and views that recently came out. Michael Bullock brought this to my attention earlier, felt that it needed to be addressed, and I'm like, you know what? You're darn right it needs to be addressed, and we're going to do that right here and now, because that's what we do here. We're top-notch here on the show. You're not getting any half-assed efforts here. No, you're getting the very best in pro wrestling and sports coverage here. That's what we do here. We take this seriously, and that's what we're going to do here, right here and now. We'll get to the Raw review in a little bit. Don't worry. And then, of course, my Tony's take on a very long night of Impact Wrestling, if I do say so myself. And, of course, Thursday Night SmackDown, and Fletcher will have his Mikey's Mindset, where he'll talk about Ring of Honor and Lucha Underground, some exciting things going in the world of the Luchas. No RWA stuff. Paige arrested after Money in the Bank after a qual, after an incident with Alberto Del Rio, her boyfriend, as we all know. They are dating. And the Facebook post that was shared said, well, if domestic violence goes both ways, she's done. And, well, apparently she's not done, because she was on the show tonight. Paige was. So apparently, but Matt Ward said Paige's mother debunked the story on Twitter. So I really don't know what's going on with this whole thing, but what I do know is that a domestic dispute is not funny, and it's something that needs to be addressed more. And, you know, if there's one thing that the four of us don't like in this country, it's injustice. And, you know, stories of injustice and hard times, and, you know, because we've had a lot of it. And I've never seen a month stretch where, you know, we've had close to home deaths and just plain old hard times. And it's, you know, it's at the point of go away. And apparently, Ward's saying that Paige's mother has debunked this story on Twitter, so I guess there's really nothing to make of it, I guess. I really don't know what to make of it, but Jerry Lawler, on the other hand, I mean, here's a guy who's no stranger to legal troubles. I mean, he's had legal troubles for many years, including 1993, which caused him to miss the Survivor Series, where it was supposed to be him and the Knights going up against Bret Hart and his brothers in that infamous Family Feud match, which ended up being Shawn Michaels instead of Jerry Lawler, because he had a legal issue at that time. And, you know, it saddens me. I mean, because, you know, Jerry Lawler, I mean, His comment, I mean, I got to be honest. His heel commentary shtick, I mean, hasn't really done anything with me. I mean, some weeks it does, other weeks, but more so it really hasn't. And, I mean, I really don't know what else to make of it, you know. Just trying to get my notes here. I apologize. But, but apparently, nothing has been made of it, so I don't see any new information about the Paige situation. But as far as Jerry Lawler is concerned, news came out today that they both appeared in court today in Memphis, Tennessee. Jerry Lawler and his young fiance appeared in a Memphis court on Monday for the first time since they were both charged with domestic assault on Friday morning. The judge ordered no communication between the couple and set a court date of July 1st. The young girl's attorney, Mark Messler, told WMC-TV that the next hearing will likely be when a course of action is determined. On that day, decisions will get made about whether this case can be settled, whether it can be dropped, whether we are going to settle, go to a trial, or a hearing. And then Jason Powell said Lawler and his attorney both declined to comment, even though Lawler already spoke with WMC on Friday morning while at the jailhouse. Messler also noted that the terms set by the judge are standard bail conditions in a domestic violence case. As for Lawler's status with WWE, I would be very surprised if they brought him back before July 1st, as he remains indefinitely suspended by the company. So, yeah, I would be too. I mean, if it's an indefinite suspension, that means, who knows? I mean, it really doesn't. We really don't know when he's going to be back. But the question is, who's going to be taking over his role at the commentator desk? I mean, we already know Mauro Ranallo's still going to be there. We know Byron Saxton is still going to be there. The hot name that's been thrown around has been Corey Graves, and that's the name that everybody wants to see. Eventually, not only take over for Lawler during this suspension, but to take over for Lawler altogether. Many feel that Jerry Lawler should no longer be an employee of World Wrestling Entertainment, including Michael Fletcher, because, you know, we talked about that during our Strictly Sports chat after the show the other night. So, my friends, I guess there's really nothing to make of the Paige situation, because I haven't seen anything. I haven't seen any new news about that. But the Jerry Lawler situation does need to be addressed. And
Flair, I actually got new news about the Paige situation.
Please share.
All right. According to Dee Dee Woodson, and I'm actually confirming this right now because I'm actually checking on the page. Apparently, what happened was there was a quarrel between Paige and with Alberto Del Rio. However, there is no arrest. There was no arrest. She was detained. I think it was kind of more like a detox type of the thing. And she was taken to the hospital for undisclosed reason. However, she wasn't, basically, she was never arrested for domestic violence. That's what it is. She never assaulted Alberto Del Rio, or Del Rio never laid his hands on Paige. Probably a shouting match broke out, and that really was what went down. WrestleNews.com says, this is what they're saying. As previously reported that Paige has been arrested sometime for an assault following some sort of incident with Alberto Del Rio, the reports are being denied by Paige's mother, Shakira Knight. According to ProWrestlingSheets.com, what took place is not a segment of either Total Divas or Swerve. It was indeed a real-life situation. Report states that Paige and Del Rio were arguing outside of Caesar's Palace, the same city in which Money in the Bank was gonna go down. Paige attempted to run across the Flamingo and Las Vegas Boulevard and ended up getting handcuffed and detained by police who were present for her safety. From there, she was taken to a local hospital for a mental evaluation, often referred as a legal 2000. This means the authorities are allowed to detain an individual who may become dangerous to themselves or others or other individuals. She was never arrested. She was never arrested and was later released by police and was never booked at any time. She was, and as clearly we saw tonight on Monday Night Raw, she did appear. So, I mean, what could have happened? We don't know. Could this have been alcohol infused? Possibly. I mean, sometimes emotional things do happen when a little bit of some alcohol gets thrown around. It could have been that. Could have been something that could have been like a little bit of an infight between Del Rio and Paige that kind of escalated to something that maybe should not have happened. More embarrassing than anything else for the WWE, but at least it was not a situation where, you know, a domestic dispute had broken out or anything like that. I think in that situation, we can live with, you know, something like this to happen more than anything else. Even though, like I said, it's kind of more of an embarrassing black eye for WWE, but nothing more than that. So, Anthony, if you'd like to go on with your thoughts, you can go right ahead.
Well, I'd like to get the thoughts of our other panelists here. You've already heard from Michael Fletcher, so Michael Bullock, Dee Dee Whitson, whoever wants to chime in next, feel free.
I'll chime in next. I mean,
all right.
Yeah, this is just strange with this whole Paige situation. I mean, I did see the photo that that Mike Fletcher posted. I mean, and I was the one who broke it to Anthony Florio first. Yeah, so, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I only go with what I saw earlier, and I don't, and of course, with just what Michael Fletcher says, but, well, we just hope this is nothing serious. But, yeah, I mean, this is now where Paige really needs to be careful now, next time, because if she does, I mean, she does anything like this again, she may be in trouble with WWE, so we'll wait and see. But there's really nothing else for me to add to this whole thing. I mean, we're just going to have to wait and find out when we get more details. I mean, I know Fletch already went into it, but who knows? Maybe there might be more details from the story. Hopefully we'll find out more. But, as far as the Jerry Lawler situation, oh, man, it's sad. I mean, here's a man who, a few years ago, I mean, survived a heart attack. I mean, this on a live edition of Monday Night Raw, and he managed to survive it, and now he's going through this with this whole domestic violence situation with his girlfriend. It's basically a he said, she said thing. I mean, when it comes to this whole thing, I mean, both of them were basically arrested, and yeah, so yeah, I mean, this is, it's just so strange how it comes to this, and, yeah, so, I mean, now they're basically, both have been released, and, yeah, so, what happens next? I mean, only time will tell, so, but, yeah, I mean, with this, I mean, this is definitely gonna put a black eye in WWE, especially Jerry the King Lawler. I mean, with him being suspended indefinitely, and who knows? I mean, I mean, like you said, this is not the first time he's had legal trouble. Like you said, in 1993. Yeah, so I don't know. Could they give Jerry Lawler another chance and have him back when they decide to lift the suspension from him? I don't know. We're just going to have to wait and find out. But if they do decide to get rid of him, I do think Corey Graves deserves the opportunity to be a commentator on the main roster. So it's an unfortunate situation, especially for both of these. But I'm so sick and tired of all this hard times nonsense, whether it's death that hit close to home. These arrests that have been made, and you know what? I'm gonna go on the record of saying this. I am so freaking done with 2016. 2017 cannot get here fast enough because I don't want to hear any more hard times nonsense. All this Dinkelberg nonsense. Ugh. I don't know what else there is to say, except I'm just done with this nonsense. Please, Fletcher, move on.
I'm just going to give my 2 cents quickly, because as far as the Paige thing goes, there's not enough information, I believe, for us to give any type of valid standpoint, at least as that goes. But I do want to say something about the Jerry Lawler thing. Look, we all know, and we've always harped that, you know, if a man ever lays a finger on a woman, you're not a man, you're a coward, you're this, you're that. But what about a woman beating up a man? I mean, look, I'm going to say this. Apparently, in the Jerry Lawler thing, they both did physical fighting on each other. So, I mean, two wrongs don't make a right here. And if we're going to give a lot of backlash to Jerry Lawler for what he did, I think we have to be fair and give backlash to this woman for beating up Jerry Lawler. I mean, it has to be fair. And sometimes the truth does hurt. I do know that a weapon was involved, or supposedly a gun was introduced, but we don't know who brought it in. She's saying that Jerry did it. He's saying she brought it to the fray, but thank God the gun was never used. I think that it could have gotten a lot worse than what it did. Obviously, it was also alcohol infused as well. A moral of the story, don't do alcohol, people. I don't care who you are. Look, I only do alcohol and I only drink once in a blue moon. And when I do, I have like a Smirnoff Ice or a Mike's Hard Lemonade. You don't hear anything about me doing vodka, whiskey, all this other junk. I mean, I did like one Patron shot for my birthday because I got influenced by Kaiser Butler, and I was fine. And don't worry, nothing bad happened that night. But I'm going to say this. It happens. But I just don't feel in this situation that, you know, Jerry Lawler is getting a lot of grief, and he rightfully so deserves it because of what he did. I'm sorry. WWE says they got a zero tolerance for domestic violence. Adam Rose got fired because of this. If what's good for the goose is good for the gander. I'm sorry. If Jerry Lawler does not get fired by the WWE for this incident, then this is a double standard in WWE, and I would go absolutely off. You want a cerebral viper? I will give you a cerebral viper rant. You would have to hide the women and the children because I would go crazy at that point. So I'm sorry. If Jerry Lawler is guilty of this, or if whatever the case may be, this is zero tolerance. There's no business in it in wrestling. There's no business in a workplace for it or in society. I'm sorry. I said it in the chat with Anthony and Michael Bullock. Jerry Lawler should be fired, and I'm sticking to my that analogy. He did it. If he did this like they claim that he did, there is no doubt in my mind what the punishment should be. I don't care if this is from Triple H. I don't care if this is from Vince himself. I don't even give a damn it's from Kevin Dunn. I'm sorry. Jerry Lawler should not be a part of World Wrestling Entertainment ever again because of this. And a statement and a quotation, period. I rest my case.
Dang.
DD Woodson, you care to follow that?
Well, before you let DD Woodson, I hate to say this to you guys, but somehow I do get this bad feeling that maybe WWE is going to give Jerry Lawler another chance. I'm not saying that it's going to happen, but I just get this bad feeling because, I mean, we know some of the mistakes WWE has made in the past. So, as much as I don't want to see Jerry Lawler back, I get this bad feeling we will. So, just saying.
All right, DD Woodson, what says you? DD, you there?
DD, can we hear you?
Better?
That's better.
Okay. Some people, they just never learn. You know, they always say, you learn the hard way. Well, some people don't even learn the hard way. You would think after having the heart issue that, you know, he would completely change his ways and everything, but apparently, no, it didn't happen. Am I surprised in it? No. Will he do it again? More likely. I do agree with Fletch that, you know, you say you have a no-tolerance policy, then you need to let him go. And unfortunately, you know, he doesn't need to be working anywhere if this is how he's gonna react. I mean, we've seen all these happen in music. We've seen it happen in football. We've seen it happen just about every sporting event or, you know, sports team out there. You know, you even have, you know, even like in NASCAR and stuff like that. There's, you know, it's just a story that just keeps popping up every year. And every year you have the same hard times. Every year we all say, you know, we want the year over with because of the hard times, and it's not going to end. You know, just face it. We could be in 2020 and it year 2020 and it's still, we'd hear somebody went out and hit somebody, and whether it's male or female. As far as, you know, that goes, you know, if the female hit the guy, she deserves the same treatment and same punishment as the guy does, you know, in my opinion. I don't want to get too personal here, but we've had that in our family where the female was beating on the male. I'm not going to say who it was in the family. I will tell you it wasn't me or Kevin, but we've had it happen before in the family where the female was abusive to the guy, and you know, rest her soul, she's passed on now. But it, you know, it's just something. It's not something talked about as often where the female is the abuser, but it happens, and it's the same damage to a guy that's being the victim as it is a female being the victim. You know, you just, it doesn't change. And, you know, I think that it's time that everyone and every one of these companies puts their foot down and say, okay, look, you have this history in your past. We're not going to hire you. I mean, child abusers have to go on a registry. Let's do the same thing for abusers. Put them on a registry. Let the whole world know what's going on. Don't hide it, and don't sit here and try to make excuses for it. Don't sit here and say, oh, well, he's a Hall of Famer. We can't fire him. Yet, this one over here is just talent. He's not that important, but we can send him on his way. No. Adam Rhodes did it. Jerry Lawler did it. Both of them need to go. You kicked one to the curb. Now it's time to kick the other one to the curb. And it's time to get a little bit harder on these people. You say you have this wellness policy, this drug policy, this no tolerance policy. Prove it. Put your foot down, WWE. Prove that this is your policy, this is what you stand by, and don't go back on it. No excuses. Once and for all, you stand up for the company, and you do not let these idiots basically come in here and just ruin your product. And that's basically what you're going to do if you let Jerry stay in the company. How many times are you going to give these people extra chances? There shouldn't be any extra chances if that's what your policy is. No three-strike rule, especially with this, because this could lead down the road to other issues that you don't want to deal with. So stick with your guns. No exceptions, no excuses. Just take the bull by the horn and write up the pink slip and say, nah, 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 hey, 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 goodbye. I'm done.
Well, let me just say it like this. I don't know about you guys, but I'm just about ready to move on to some more positive stuff. I don't know about you guys. You ready to move on to something more positive? I know I am. So, but we'll definitely monitor the situation as we go forward. Yes, Bullet?
Yeah. Well, we definitely need to move on to something positive because I know if we get something more negative, I know Fletch and Dee Dee Woodson are really going to go off. And trust me, the last thing you want to do is piss these two off.
And us too, Bullet. Don't forget it.
I know us too, but Fletcher and Dee Dee Woodson are more vocal than we are.
Very true. Very true. And so with all that being said, we'll definitely, you know, keep an eye out on this situation, you know, as it develops, with this Paige situation and with the Jerry Lawler situation. Of course, I just mentioned that little update I found a little bit ago. Him and his fiance, her name is Lauren McBride. They're going to have a court date on July 1st, which is a week from Friday. So we'll see what comes out of that. We'll definitely have an exclusive, I'm sure, on that. We'll see what happens with Jerry Lawler from there. And we'll see about the Paige situation, if anything more comes out of that. And one other news bit that came out today, and this is positive, by the way. We finally have a date for the brand extension draft. And how about this? As if July 19th couldn't get any bigger. I mean, you know July 19th is going to be the debut of our brand new second edition of the Wrestling Forum, which we're going to have on Tuesday nights, which will be hosted by our own Cerebral Viper, Michael Fletcher. That first live SmackDown, it's draft night. How about it? How about it? So that's on July 19th, and I know I speak on behalf of everybody here when I say we couldn't be any more excited or any more delighted. I mean, July 19th, I mean, we thought we were just going to be recapping SmackDown, and, you know, like we usually do with Raw and all that yada yada, but what we're going to do is I think we're also going to be recapping the draft picks, I'm sure. So, as if that show couldn't get any bigger. So, mark it down, folks. July 19th, exactly a month from now. That first Tuesday SmackDown, our first Tuesday Forum, we're not only going to be recapping SmackDown, we're also going to be recapping the draft as well. So, we're going to have some fun with that. So now, let's move on to what you all came here for, honestly. And that is our review of Monday Night Raw, 24 hours removed from one half of the tag team known as the greatest Shakespearean drama night of all time, Money in the Bank. It was that and the NBA Finals with the Cleveland Cavaliers making their history. So right now, let's dive right in. And what a better way to start it off than with the brand new WWE World Heavyweight Champion, the Lunatic Fringe, Dean Ambrose. He comes out. You know, cuts a promo about winning the title, you know, in vintage Dean Ambrose fashion. I'm sure Michael Fletcher's going to, you know, wax poetic on that because I know how much Fletcher loves Ambrose's quirks, if you will, and what I would consider somewhat of offbeat shenanigans a la Lance Storm from the invasion angle. But nonetheless, he cuts a promo. He gets interrupted by Roman Reigns, and let me tell you, you don't usually think of Phoenix, Arizona as an IWC territory. Well, guess what? The IWC clearly took over the America West Arena in Phoenix, Arizona tonight. Oh, yeah, they took over. Because once Roman's music hits, boo! Oh, my goodness, did they let him have it. I mean, that ranks up there as one of the greatest boo tracks I've ever heard in my life, believe me. And then you bring out Seth Rollins, IWC explodes, and Seth Rollins shows up, and then Shane O'Mac shows up, and Shane O'Mac announces that we would have a number one contenders match with Seth Rollins against Roman Reigns, and the winner would face Dean Ambrose for the WWE World Heavyweight Championship at Battleground on July 24th. At the Verizon MCI Center in Washington D.C. So, yeah. What else is there to say except this? To me, I got to say this. Well, this is one of the segments of the night. I don't know if this was the segment of the night because, you know, we had a couple of other good segments, but I thought this was one of the top highlights, one of the top segments and highlights of the night. I mean, Ambrose. I mean, it was also the crowd. I mean, I love the IWC crowd. I mean, we love IWC crowds. All of us do. Especially the night after a hot pay-per-view when Dean Ambrose showed up and, you know, before Ambrose was ready to cut his promo, we had the infamous "You deserve it" chant, and yeah, you damn right he deserves it. What else is there to say? I mean, and then Ambrose cut his promo, he acknowledged the crowd, saying he had a long night in Vegas. Talked about the Cleveland Cavaliers, how he almost got bitten by a dog, but then moved on to winning the Money in the Bank briefcase and cashing in on Seth Rollins, and said that the lesson learned last night was that what goes around comes around, and the second was that hard work pays off, busting your ass and keeping your nose to the grindstone pays off, and when it does, it pays off big. And Ambrose said that Rollins calls himself the man, Reigns calls himself the guy, so he must be the dude. And then he was going to move on to say that all the struggle and hard times were worth it, and that he was standing in the middle of the ring with the title, and there wouldn't be no hard times anymore. Believe that when I see it. Ambrose celebrated, and then Roman Reigns, and that did it right there. And then, you know, he says, "Hey, I'm happy for him." And then he actually acknowledged the IWC crowd. He said, He said, to all you IWC haters out there, take a sip of your beer and shut up. That sounded a little heelish to me. And then Rollins came out and said, no. I achieved my dream last night by beating Roman. And that, Roman, you got to go to the back of the line. And then that's when Shane comes out and makes his, makes the announcement that Reigns and Rollins would fight again in a number one contenders match, and the winner would face Dean Ambrose for the title at Battleground. So, like I said, one of the segments of the night. This was a phenomenal segment. I mean, anytime these three get together, you know it's gold. You know it's must-see television, and that's exactly what we got here tonight, must-see television. And I could not have been any more delighted with how this segment turned out. And to get another Reigns-Rollins match, I mean, that's good. I mean, especially after that classic they had last night at Money in the Bank. So that's all there is to say about it for me. It's one of the segments of the night. And Michael Bullock, we had a lot. I mean, Michael Bullock and I, we do our Raw chat like we always do. And I can honestly say that I think Bullock, after what we did tonight, after the Raw chat we had tonight, I don't think we ever had more fun doing a Raw chat than we ever had in our entire since we started doing the Raw chat, whenever it was. So. Michael Bullock, I bring you back in. Your thoughts on this segment, and all I can say is, when we did our Raw chat tonight, I can honestly say, I mean, they've all been great, don't get me wrong, but I think tonight, I think we had the most fun we ever had during a Raw chat. But I don't know, is it just me, or is it just me?
No, we certainly had one heck of a fun night with our Raw chat, and I think it was the best one we've ever had since we started doing it. So, yeah, I do agree. This was one of the segments of the night. I mean, everybody played their parts well, and yeah, I mean, Shane McMahon, like you said, he comes out and says, you know what, Roman Reigns and Seth Rollins will fight each other tonight, and the winner will face Dean Ambrose for the WWE World Heavyweight Championship at Battleground. So. Yeah, so what happens when it comes to this match? You're going to have to wait and find out later on during this review. So, yeah, so it's definitely one of the top segments of the night. So, Fletch, I give it to you.
Yeah, definitely one of the top segments of the night. It was definitely an amazing event. How awesome is it? Dean Ambrose, WWE World Heavyweight Champion, man. He's just the blue collar guy. You know, he's hardworking. He used a little bit of the puns. You know, practice makes perfect. Everything else. You know, and I love the fact that he was like, you know what, I was at the right place at the right time at the right moment to take out Seth Rollins after, you know, Seth won the belt. And, you know, Roman Reigns came out. Of course, he gets booed. And you know what? Wasn't it weird? But didn't you sense a little bit of the, you know, of the heel Roman Reigns? Telling the fans, all you guys out there, yeah, go, well, keep sitting. Why don't you just go, pipe down, drink your beers, and shut up. I'm like, damn, Roman? Really? Whoa. I don't think the face of the company is supposed to do something like that, but, you know, it is what it is. I'll tell you one thing. It definitely was very interesting. I love Shane O'Mac showing up, setting the table for what was undoubtedly going to be a great night tonight. So, oh, yeah, I definitely like what I saw, and I think it was definitely one of the top segments of the night, no doubt about it. So with that said, Dee Dee Woodson, I give it to you.
This was definitely a very awesome segment. I really enjoyed it, probably more than I enjoyed most of the rest of the show. I kind of like how when Seth did come out, you know, he's sitting here saying how he was cheated and how Dean attacked him from behind and not coming at his face, and you know, Roman saying, "Well, now you know how I feel," and he goes, "Well, at least I attacked you from the face. You saw me coming. I didn't see Dean coming." Well, Seth, if you remember, he already warned you the Monday before the pay-per-view that if he won the Money in the Bank ladder match, he was going to cash in. So you should have already been prepared for that. And it's kind of funny, though, you know, the music goes off, kind of going back to the pay-per-view here, and they just automatically stare at the ramp, but they don't think to look around the rest of the arena to see if maybe they're going to pull one of these stunts where they come out of the audience or come out from under the ring or whatever. And so, honestly, all I can say is Seth kind of screwed Seth by not paying closer attention to his surroundings that night. But it was a very good segment, and I really did like Shane asking his invisible sister about, you know, if she approved his idea for the main event for tonight. So, yeah, it was a strong segment, a good way to start off the show. Really also loved how Dean arrived in the taxi with the belt, because that really shows you how down-to-earth Dean can be, but also how crazy and insane he is as well. So, you know, thumbs up on the segment, and so it's yours, Florio.
All right. Yeah, what a segment that was. No question about that. So now we move on to our first match of the night. Hey, no better way to kick off the wrestling action of the show than with a match between Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens, and the winner of the match via a unique pinning combination, it was Sami Zayn. Unfortunately, I do not have a time of the fall here, so we're just going to have to wing it as far as the rating goes. So, Michael Bullock, bring you in. We definitely had some fun with this match. You know, well documented that we had a major fun during this Raw chat tonight. So Michael Bullock, Sami Zayn, Kevin Owens. Solid enough match for you, or what?
I thought it was a good match for what it was. I'll give it 2.5 stars as my rating for it. I mean, it was a little too short for my liking. I mean, I would have loved to see a little bit more. I mean, especially with the history with these two. I mean, the rivalry that's. I mean, these two used to be the best of friends. Now they've become bitter enemies, and I mean, the action was good for what it was, but I mean, I just wanted to see a little bit more out of this, if I'm going to be quite honest. So Sami Zayn gets the win. Of course, I guess you could say it's a little bit of a payback from Payback when these two went at it. Of course, Kevin Owens got the win in that one, but after the match, it was not over between these two. I mean, Kevin Owens basically took a cheap shot at Sami Zayn, and then they basically just brawled into the back, and it took referees, security, and heck, we even saw Finlay and the Road Dogg basically trying to help out and separate these two. So. Yeah, but something tells me that the war is far from over between these two. And something tells me I think we're going to get another encounter between these two, probably at Battleground. So we'll wait and see how it all goes. But either way, 2.5 stars, a good match for what it was. Just wanted to see a little bit more out of this. I mean, especially with the body of work of these two, so... So, Fletch, your thoughts on a rivalry renewed with Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens?
You know, what else is there to say? Every time these two guys get going, it's always amazing. It's always awesome. It's always fun. But this time around, I wish we got something more out of it. Like you said, I could give this about maybe 1.5 to 2 stars is my rating for the fight. I was definitely a little disappointed. I was looking for something a little more because we've known the rivalry so bad. These guys have torn each other apart how many times? So, I mean, these guys have gone through so many battles, so many wars. Unfortunately, this time around, not one of their better battles. But then again, these guys kind of poured their hearts out last night in the Money in the Bank ladder match. So we knew that they weren't going to be at 100%. So, I mean, it was good for what it was worth. But like you said, it kind of left a little bit of a sour taste in our mouth because we kind of were hoping for something more than that. So, Deedee, it's yours.
I definitely agree with Fletcher on the rating. You know, it was really short. You know, hats off to Sammy for finally getting one over on Kevin, but it did lead to Kevin attacking on the ramp and the major brawl backstage. You can tell this isn't over, but not by a long shot. But, yeah, it was just really a match that just, it was okay for an opener, but it just wasn't, you know, wasn't up to my standards of, you know, being what I was expecting to see out of the two. So it's yours, Florio.
2.5 stars, definitely agree with that rating, no question about it. That's the rating I gave Bullock when Bullock asked me what I thought of the match during our Raw chat, and I agreed. I mean, I thought it was on its way to becoming something really good, but it ended out of nowhere. You know, Zayn wins it with a unique pinning combination. Not a roll-up, but it was one of those jackknife-type covers, and that's exactly what it was, and the match was over like that, but it was very good for what it was. It's one of the top matches of the night. It's not the fight of the night, honestly, but you know, I did feel a little underwhelmed, and because of the fact that these two are capable of so much, and you know, but you can understand, you know, because you know, the Money in the Bank ladder match. We all know how brutal that match is, and these two definitely put their hearts on the line in that one, and then of course. Now, that brawl, I mean, that was one of the most intense brawls I've seen since the infamous Brock Lesnar Undertaker brawl from last summer, the night after Battleground. I mean, the one that Michael Bullock and I, you know, had so much fun with beyond belief. So, but nonetheless, it's definitely a 2.5-star rating. I definitely agree with that. Deedee Woodson had to step out for a moment, so... I hope she'll indicate when she'll be back. So it's 2.5 stars. I definitely agree with that rating. That's the rating I had initially. So, yeah, I would have liked to have seen a little more, but, you know, it is what it is. I mean, it was an enjoyable match, especially considering the abuse both men took just the night before in the Money in the Bank ladder match. Did more than I expected and managed to put their feud back on the front burner in the process. Can't wait for them to get to a point where they can get 20 to 25 minutes on a network special, because they have impressed even in the shorter matches they have had thus far. So let's see what happens with that. Well, coming up, then we have the brawl, and then we go back out to ringside. We go back out ringside, and who shows up? Much to the delight of Michael James Bullock, his buddy, his amigo, his camarada.
My name is Mr. John Laurinaitis, and I am the Executive Vice President of Talent Relations and the former General Manager of Raw and SmackDown.
Yeah.
Get the you-know-what out with that shit.
Come on, Bullock. I mean, it's no denying. I mean, when we were doing our Raw chat, I mean... Don't deny it. You were breaking out the balloons and the party hats for good.
Oh, bull crap! Bull crap! Because
everybody knows how much Michael Bullock worships the ground this dynamic dude walks on. Right?
Oh, are you kidding me? He doesn't. Are you kidding?
As soon as I heard that music, I'm like, No, wait.
But Florio is absolutely right. He does the Wayne's World thing. I'm not worthy. I'm scum. I suck.
Yes, indeed, Fletch. And but all I can say, let me just say like this. I mean, Bullock was definitely, I'm just having fun with him. I mean, let me be real honest. I mean, you saw the Michael Bullock I can't take it face. I mean, to be real honest with you guys, Michael Bullock is actually not a fan of John Laurinaitis. I mean, if you've watched our shows in the past, I mean, Michael Bullock has gone on some major tirades about John Laurinaitis, saying about how stale and boring he is. But there was one thing before I started with Michael Fletcher, and because this was a brief little segment which led into a tag match, and it's gonna be one of our 2-for-1 segments in just a moment. But the one thing that I gotta laugh out of, not just because of Bullock going bonkers and not in a good way for John Laurinaitis, but what really did it for me was JBL on commentary was absolutely going crazy. I mean, he was like, people power. He was like, yeah, there's all of you. I mean, JBL was like a kid in a candy store. Let me just tell you that right now, seeing John Laurinaitis. So, but yeah, John Laurinaitis came out, another authority figure pleading his case to run SmackDown. Because, you notice they had the podiums. They had a Raw podium and a SmackDown podium. Because we all know they were teasing us. They were giving us a tease of what it's going to be like on draft night next month. So that's the story behind that. But in case you were wondering. So, now that we got all that out of the way, now that we had all our fun out of the way, don't worry, Bullock. That's the last time I'm gonna, rub you that way. We're gonna have some fun for the rest of this night. So then Laurinaitis does his shtick. Shane McMahon comes down and says, "You're not doing anything. You're out of here." And then it led into a tag team match. Enzo and Cass going up against the Vaude Villains. Winners of the match. Unfortunately, I don't have a time of the fall again. With the Bada Boom Shakalaka, Enzo and Cass wins the match over the Vaude Villains. So, Gurl MF, Cerebral Viper, Michael Fletcher, we started off with you. Your thoughts on not just the tag bout, but also the surprise appearance of
Mr. John Laurinaitis.
First off, I want to say that when I saw Johnny Ace show up, I was like, okay, interesting. But then again, we've seen a lot of people in the past, recently make their returns to, WWE. We had Teddy Long. We've had some other people coming around in the past. I get it. I understand why they're doing it. It's kind of one of those things, but, nothing bad, nothing big, about that. But I do want to say when Shane McMahon came out and like, look, we need somebody young. We need somebody brash. We need somebody who's going to be, in your face, this and that. You know what? Can I say something? They talk about a new generation, and I get it. I think I have a candidate for you for general manager of one of the two shows. And I don't know how this is going to go or how people's going to feel about this, but I think I'm about to cause quite a ruckus in the room. In a good way, though. I mean, you need somebody charismatic. Somebody that you said that will listen to the people. Okay. I have a guy who's originally from Aberdeen, Washington. A man who was a former World Heavyweight Champion, a former Intercontinental Champion, And, oh, by the way, was created this little movement called the Yes Movement.
Yes, yes, yes.
I'm thinking, or Shane, if you and I are in the same...
Yes, 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 yes.
Okay, hold on. Before you gentlemen start jumping off the deep end and start going nuts on this form, let me get my two cents out, because you already know where this is heading. But I'm going to say it anyway. Shane O'Mac, I know you don't really watch the wrestling form, but I think you kind of have a tendency to start watching us lately. D.D. Woodson brought out a good point last night. Shane, if you are listening to this, which if you are, thank you. You want ratings? You want people to really go crazy? I suggest that you fly to Seattle, Aberdeen, or wherever, and you track down Daniel Bryan. And, you know, open a conversation with him. Maybe offer him one of the two shows. Now, doesn't matter if it's Raw or SmackDown. Preferably, I would choose SmackDown over Raw. But whatever the case may be, go with him. You're not going to be disappointed. Now, as far as the match, as far as Enzo and Cass and the Vaudevillains goes, before Enzo and Cass came out, they all started going nuts in the whole nine yards. But Shane O'Mac, there was a moment that I need to say, I got to look at your shoes, and what are those? That was what Enzo was basically doing, man. He was looking at your kicks like, dude, really? What the bleep with those, man? So, it was funny. It was awesome. Enzo does his shtick. Kaz does their shtick. The crowd's all amped up for them. They're the most popular team. Vaudevillains come out. Solid tag team fight. And you know what? I got to say it. You know, they did the bada boom, boom shakalaka. They got the 1-2-3. Big win for Enzo and Kaz. You know, they go up the ladder. Vaudevillains drop a little bit. Good fight. 2 stars is what I'm thinking. And I guess we know that for tonight and tonight only, the Vaudevillains, well, there was definitely one word to describe you. And I'm going to spell it out for you.
Come on. Hey.
Hey. Hey. Dolly. No. Hey.
Dee Dee Woodson, it's all yours, sweetheart.
Oh, Lord. Okay. I guess I'm in the same boat with Bullock. I cannot stand Johnny Ace. And as, you know, I will agree with Enzo on one thing, because I have said this before. He is Johnny Laryngitis, because he definitely needs to do something about the fact that he can't speak. He sounds like he's trying to talk after smoking something, so, man. It was kind of a cool segment between him and Shane, and him trying to say, well, Shane, you take SmackDown, I'll take Raw. You know, just giving him his little opinions and stuff. But, yeah, it was... That was kind of cool. Then the little dance between Shane and Enzo going back and forth on the ring, or the ramp up there. As far as the shoes, from what I have been hearing... Shane is getting custom shoes made, and of course they're, you know, pretty darn expensive for a McMahon to be paying for custom shoes, but from what I understand, it's got his name engraved into the shoes or somewhere. So they're pretty top of the line there. But I've told you all I'm not that big of a Enzo and Cass fan, but they're growing on me. I still don't understand Enzo half the time, but I definitely think that he did a pretty darn good job, describing his thoughts on Johnny Ace being out there. And I would definitely agree, Johnny Ace is soft. I'm not going to try to say it the way you guys do, because I would, being an Okie, I would just destroy the whole thing, because my accent doesn't quite meet with y'all. As for the match, I'll agree with Fletch. It was 2 stars. It was a fairly good match. I kind of enjoyed it. It definitely showed who the better team was, and so I'm not going to say too much more about it. I'm just going to kind of toss it up.
Yeah, no question about it. It's between 1.5 and 2 as far as the match is concerned. As for the Laurinaitis segment, like I said, Bullock and I, boy, did we have fun with this. Bullock absolutely lost his mind, and not in a good way, because, it's well documented, the hatred that he has for John Laurinaitis. So, Dee Dee Whitson, you're not alone on that. And as far as this is concerned, that Enzo stick. I'm gonna make this point. I think I made it once before on this show, and I'm gonna make it again. Monday Night Raw is gonna be coming to our neck of the woods, of Providence, Rhode Island, at the Dunkin' Donuts Center next month on Monday night, July the 18th, which is the go home for Battleground. And I've mentioned this to Bullock many times during our Raw chats, and I'm sure Michael Fletcher will agree with us. Can you imagine if Enzo and Cass show up at the Dunk? Can you imagine how over those two guys are going to be here in Providence, in our neck of the woods, guys? Can you just imagine it? Can you imagine what that crowd's going to be like when Enzo and Cass show up and do their shtick? Mayhem. That's all I can say about it. So, as for that Daniel Bryan idea, why not? He can't wrestle anymore. Just because he can't wrestle anymore doesn't mean he can't help out the company in some way. If they brought him in as the general manager, that crowd would definitely the crowd would definitely pop like they never popped before. It would be just as big as the Miracle on Bourbon Street pop, if you know what I mean. So, but we'll see. You never know. But I still think it's gonna be. Shane or Stephanie. I think it's going to be Shane. One of them's going to run Raw and the other's going to run SmackDown. That's just how I feel about it. But we'll see. We'll just have to wait and see how management decides to go about it. So, I think that's why you briefly stepped out, Dee Dee Whitson. That's what Michael Fletcher said. Michael Fletcher came up with that idea. So, but we'll see. We'll see how it goes. So, the segment was, that little segment was fine for what it was. The only reason why I would say it was great to see John Laurinaitis is because I love when it would get a rise out of Michael Bullock, because I was expecting a rise out of Michael Bullock, and I damn sure got one and then some. So the match was 1.5 to 2. So with that said, Michael Bullock, your thoughts on all the craziness, including the return of quote unquote your boy John Laurinaitis?
Please, I'm not even going to waste my time on the whole John Laurinaitis thing. You guys pretty much touched on it. I feel like I don't want to get any more on this, because I'll go off if I talk about it. So, but as far as the match goes, 1.5 to 2 stars. It was fine for what it was, so what does this mean now for Enzo and Big Cass? Could they become... could they receive a future shot at the WWE Tag Team titles? Well, there's another certain team that could have something to say about that. We'll get into that as we go about this this review. So, that being said, Florio, let's just move on.
Oh man, we just had a lot of fun with that, but well, we're gonna really have some fun now. The phenomenal AJ Styles. Yes, the phenomenal AJ Styles came out. You know, cut a promo about that controversial win over John Cena at Money in the Bank. And he said, "Hey, if the club is to continue, I need them to come down and give me a public apology right now." They made their way down, but then AJ told him that he didn't need their help and that they had given John Cena an excuse. And Anderson said they were trying to help, but AJ said he had signed on the dotted line and dragged his name through the mud. AJ then asked them both to look him into the eyes to apologize, clearly treating it as a joke. And they gave tongue-in-cheek apologies to Styles, and then AJ said they had one more apology to make to John Cena. He asked Cena to come out, and Cena said, "Hey, I don't need an apology." Cena said, "They had a contract, you broke it." Gallo said that AJ had no idea they were going to come out, and then apologized to Cena. Anderson said AJ had signed the contract, but they didn't, and they took advantage of it, so he was sorry. Cena saw through it, of course, and said AJ is using his club as an excuse because he's not as good as he says he is. And then AJ said that Cena was using the two of them as an excuse because he's not as good as he says he is. And then Cena chimed in and said that he respects winning, but second to that, he respects a man who sticks to his word. He then said, "Sometimes all you have are your balls and your word." And last night, AJ proved he didn't have either one of them. Wow. AJ said last night Gallows and Anderson did Cena a favor by giving him an excuse. He said Cena can face any member of the club that he wants. Cena interrupted and said he wanted Styles right now. And AJ said he didn't let him finish. It's any member except him. Gallows and Anderson get involved. AJ had already beaten him anyway. Cena said it didn't matter which one he faced because it was always going to be one on three whenever they realized that he would knock any one of their teeth down their throat in a fair fight. Styles said he was dead wrong, and that Carl Anderson would knock his teeth down his throat and prove he wasn't as good as he thought he was. And then AJ loved his appearance on a local podcast on the WWE Network. And then it led into the match, John Cena versus Machine Gun Carl Anderson. Cena wins it by a disqualification after Gallows got involved. And then a Magic Killer and a Styles Clash later, so I believe it's Dee Dee Woodson who starts this off. So, Dee Dee Woodson, your thoughts on this very long promo segment and then the eventual match with John Cena and Machine Gun Anderson?
Okay, this is where I said at the beginning of the show that the segments were a little bit better than the matches, because the segment, I thoroughly enjoyed it. I thought that was a very good segment, and you know, I did pretty much kind of see it coming, though, that you know AJ would say that they weren't behind him, or he wasn't behind them doing all that stuff, because he said it before. You know, remember with Roman Reigns, that whole stick where he said that he wasn't telling them to do this, that he wasn't standing behind them on that, and then it. Then they all ended up doing it all together anyway. And Cena, you could tell he was seeing through it from the first moment that AJ opened his mouth and the first moment that the two tried to give this little fake apology, which you could tell it was fake. It was all staged. It was just there for the show. And but still, I still enjoyed the segment very well. As far as the match, you don't want my thoughts on it. I'm going to give it an NA, and I'm just going to pass it on.
Segment of the night, there's no question about it here. I mean, Cena and AJ continue to be must-see television, and what else is there to say? I mean, I said they had the best build to a feud I ever saw, and you know we're going to get a rematch at Battleground. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. We're getting a rematch at Battleground, and this proved it. I mean, this was definitely the start of it. And another great back-and-forth exchange. It got real again. I mean, I mean, they've been getting real. Real, recognized, and real. Ain't that right, Michael Fletcher? I mean, looking at you. You're the one who, you and I made had a lot of fine howdy-do's with the real recognizing real. Back when Cena first uttered those famous words in 2005. So, but nonetheless, the segment was awesome. I mean, these two are just gold in these segments. I mean, I could watch these two in a verbal segment all night long and never be tired. I mean, it was just absolutely phenomenal. No pun intended. And as far as the match goes, yes, I agree with that. It is definitely an NA. I mean, never really got off the ground. I mean, you knew it wasn't going to end cleanly. So, yeah. Can you say Battleground rematch, folks? I certainly can. And when that does go down, I fully expect John Cena to get the win back. And then it will set up a rubber match between the two at SummerSlam. So that's just how I feel about it. So, segment of the night, NA for the fight. My good boy, did we have some fun? Boy, did we have some fun with this, like we had all night long with this.
Yeah, this was definitely the segment of the night here. I mean, like you said, I mean, AJ Styles, I mean, brought out Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson, trying to get him to apologize to AJ Styles, which he did, of course, for interfering, brings out John Cena. Cena, like you said, it was basically like, you know what? You broke your promise on the when you signed that contract, and then they just went at it back and forth, and man, they really were throwing down on each other. Woo! Man, and then AJ Styles says, how about you face one of the members of the club, and Cena says, how about you and me right now? But AJ's like, it's Carl Anderson. So, yeah, so definitely the segment of the night, and as far as the match goes, yeah, it's a definite NA, and I knew that we were going to have some kind of a screwy finish, and yeah, we got it here, so yeah, so I think it's definitely looking like we're going to have these two face off at Battleground, so yeah, so there's really nothing more to say except, Fletch, I give it to you.
Yeah, no doubt about it. This was definitely an NA for the match, but the segment before it, oh my god. You know, AJ Styles played that, you know, I didn't know anything that happened. You know, I can't believe my own brothers went against my own words or my own wishes. I wanted to fight John Cena one-on-one. I, you know, the contract was signed that the club was not going to get involved, and they kind of were like, yo, look, we had our own reason why we wanted to do it. We're sorry, it was all bad. Yeah, right, we knew. Wink, wink, nah, we knew the fix was in. But the thing is, like we said last night, it ruined a five-star fight, man. We had a five-star in our hands, and you mucked it on us, man. You had to resort to a stupid, rotten TNA booking that Vince Russo probably would have cooked up a few years ago. I mean, it just left a bitter taste in the mouth. We were not happy at all. But, you know, it is what it is. But the match itself, yeah, it was an NA. I mean, solid action for what it was worth. But then, you know, once again, the club show up and beat down. So, I mean, it is what it is. There's nothing more to say. Anthony, let's move on to the next segment.
Yep. All right. I was just running through my notes here. Okay. Then there were a couple of backstage segments, one with Seth Rollins, and then one with Becky Lynch, and then Natalya took her down again. So, yeah, and then it led into our next match, which was Baron Corbin one-on-one with Zack Ryder. Winner of the match, Baron Corbin via the End of Days. I gotta say, it was the worst fight of the night. This was half to one star. I mean, that's pretty much the effort. I mean, Bullock and I thought it was going to be a dud going in, but no, this match actually ended up being a little bit better than we initially thought. I mean, not that much better, but, you know, it is what it is. But, you know, it was an okay fight, nothing really to write home about. This is main event slash superstars stuff here, so not going to really waste any more time on this. No big surprise Corbin went over. I mean, he's the hot newcomer that they're definitely trying to get over here, which is working. So, yeah, you finally put him over Ziggler last night. Hopefully you can move him on to somebody other than Ziggler, and we can hopefully get him in another meaningful feud against a different talent. So that's all there is to say on that. So after 1 star, worst fight of the night. Bullock, your thoughts on Corbin and Ryder? Bullock?
Oh, I forgot to unmute my mic. I thought I did, but
no.
But yeah, half to 1 star for me. I mean, I thought this match was going to be a dud. I mean, it was all right for what it was. I mean, it really wasn't anything special. So I'm not going to get into any further details. So half to 1 star. Fletch, it's yours.
Half a star, but this was more of a story progression. Baron Corbin gets a big win, no doubt about it. I'm happy with the victory for him. But like we've been saying, you know, at the very beginning we were talking about Apollo Crews giving him opportunities, giving him some better competition. Baron Corbin, he had a shot at Dolph Ziggler, which was great. I think the rivalry definitely ran its course. Now it's time to start giving him better talent. Who knows? He might be one of those guys that could really benefit from the WWE draft when it goes down on July 19th. You know, he might be one of those guys that, you know, putting him either on Raw or SmackDown, this might be the best possibility or the best hope and dreams that you can get, because I think the rivalry will, you know, you can build bigger rivalries, nicer matches, you know, giving them some fresh faces that they could work with. I there's one rivalry I would like to see, and I know this might be a little bit of a stretch here, but what about a Baron Corbin Titus O'Neil fight? I mean, these are two guys that never faced each other before. It would be a fresh battle, fresh face. I mean, two guys that are definitely trying to rise up in the company. I mean, look at Titus O'Neil. I mean, he had a shot at the United States Championship last night the other night. He didn't win the title. Okay, fine. You know, it was unfortunate, but sometimes you don't win the titles. And I think if you give him a guy like Baron Corbin, I think this would be a good rivalry. This would be, you know, you can work around it, you know, based on it. Two young guys who are really good that you could build up together. I mean, it would be a good storyline. I think Titus O'Neil is the wily veteran, Baron Corbin, the young lion trying to make a big stand. And Titus O'Neil is, I think, other than that minor dust-up he had with Vince McMahon and, you know, during that Daniel Bryan appreciation retirement ceremony, other than that one dust-up he had, he's been quite the model citizen of WWE. I mean, he's been a really good guy. You know, we've heard about him and his children being a great father, a father figure. You know, he's definitely a be a star type of advocate, and you know, I think this guy could do a lot of like the Make a Wish foundations in the near future, and so I think he would definitely be that up and coming young guy. And Baron Corbin, who basically is the complete opposite, doesn't give a damn about the fans, doesn't give a damn, just wants to beat people up and do his business. I could see a good clash of war, a good clash between these two men. So just again, just putting it out there just for the hell of it. You know, if it works, great, yay. If it doesn't, then all right, it was worth a shot. So give me your thoughts on that too, guys. So with that said, Didi, I'll give it to you.
In my opinion, I think y'all were even too generous to give it a half a star. I did not rate it at all. Corbin, in my opinion, is the character's boring. I don't see much, you know, in him that I, you know, that I like. Yeah, he's just basically a bruiser who wants to fight, and you know, that, yeah, there was maybe some good action in there, but it was too short. There just wasn't much there at all. So as far as your idea, Fletch, that might be a interesting match to see Corbin versus Titus. You know, Titus is right now the model WWE citizen at the moment. So and it, you know, it was great to see him actually have his kids there, although, you know, that, like we said yesterday, you know, the curse of the kids and losing matches, you know, it just follows along. But as far as the match, like I said, I'm not giving it a rating, because in my opinion, the two interviews in front before it was better than the match itself. So it's yours, Florio.
Yeah, I couldn't agree with you more, Didi Woodson. Exactly right. So, and now we're going to move on to, well, it's going to be very interesting to see what everybody's thoughts are on this. A championship match. It's very rare we get title matches on Monday Night Raw, but we got one here. WWE Women's Championship on the line. America's sweetheart, if you will. Yeah, right. Charlotte with Dana Brooke. Yeah. Or as I call them now, as I just dubbed them tonight with Bullock, Laycool 2.0. Going up against Paige, WWE Women's Championship on the line, winner of the match, and still the WWE Women's Champion. It is Charlotte, natural selection after a dipsy-doo, botcheroo, distraction finish by Dana Brooke. So, all right, Michael Bullock, your thoughts on this Women's Championship match.
Bullock? What was the time of the fall, Florio?
I don't have one.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of how to rate this with the. I'm gonna give it maybe 1.5 to 2 stars as my rating for the match. I mean. It was fine for what it was. I mean, Charlotte, of course, with a little assist from Dana Brooke, of course, and just as they were celebrating, a certain boss made a return to Monday Night Raw. The boss, Sasha Banks, is back, and the moment that music hit, when me and Florio heard that, I'm like, I'm sure somewhere Michael Fletcher and, of course, Bill McConnell were probably going nuts at this, and Sasha Banks made her intentions clear. She wants that women's championship. Dana Brooke goes to the outside, attacks her. Well, basically, Sasha Banks, basically, with one big punch, takes down Dana Brooke, and it looked like she was going to go for the bank statement on Charlotte. She grabs the belt from her, and Dana Brooke attacks from behind. Paige, of course, goes after Dana Brooke, and basically, Paige and Sasha Banks stand tall, and I don't know, boys. I know we talked about Sasha Banks and Charlotte for the women's title at SummerSlam. I don't think we're going to wait that long. I think we're going to get a Battleground, if I'm going to be quite honest. Even though, in my personal opinion, they should save that for SummerSlam. But you know what? Either way, I think we're definitely going to get this match. So 1.5 to 2 stars is the rating I'm giving this match. But damn, it's good to see Sasha Banks back on Monday Night Raw. And so that being said, Fletch, I'm tossing it up to you, and I know when Sasha Banks came out, you were smiling like a Cheshire cat.
Yeah, I was. I mean, there's really nothing more to say about this. This was an absolute stunning moment. First off, the fight, yeah, I'm not going to say it was kind of a bad... It wasn't really that much of a great match, whatever. I mean, I could give this at least a half to one star. I'll give it for the effort, just for the hell of it. The quality was pretty good, but, I mean, at the end of the day, once again, you had Dana Brooke, you know, interfering right before we had, basically, it looked like Paige was going to win the title. She hit the Rampage on her. Dana Brooke puts the foot on the rope. Next thing you know, natural selection, 1, 2, 3, and Charlotte keeps the belt. You know, I mean, it is what it is. Fine, whatever. You know, Charlotte and Dana were celebrating. Next thing you know, yeah, you heard the theme music. The place explodes. And the next thing you know, yeah, the boss was back. And it didn't take very long to see what the boss was going to do. Dana Brooke, you know, she tried to go run after Sasha, try to get, like, one little shot at her. But no, she got caught with a serious punch. I mean, I've seen some nasty hits in my day, and oh man, did she get docked. Next thing you know, she basically tries to go, Charlotte tries to run off, and she actually put her in the first part of the bank statement. It wasn't the complete bank statement, because if you remember, basically after she does the knees to the back, she always used to flip over and then puts like a rear knee and basically puts like a cross face, and that is basically the full bank statement. So let's just say she got partial payment on the bank statement, but she didn't get full payment on it. She'll get full payment sooner or later. Next thing you know, it was basically, you know, it is what it is. I mean, Sasha's back. I'm happy about it. And I think that belt is going to look pretty damn nice around her waist. I don't think she'll get it right away. I think it'll be a matter of time. But one thing is for sure, this was definitely one of the top moments of the night for me. A nice surprise. Again, if she stays healthy, if she doesn't get hurt, we're looking at the next WWE Women's Champion. But like I said, she needs to stay healthy. Dee Dee, what's in this? All yours.
I gave the match about one star. You know, no, it wasn't one of the best matches, but, you know, I gave him the star for at least effort. But was the ref blind? I mean, Dana is holding the foot with the rope, and he's looking right at her and does nothing until he's counted like two or something, whatever. And then he waits till the last minute to kick her out and barely turns around in time to watch Charlotte get a pin. I mean, it's poor. It, you know, it's just not something that you would expect to see in a match. And, you know, I think Dana's definitely proving that she's more harm than good when it comes to, quote, helping Charlotte. So, as far as after the match, you know, I was excited, even excited to see Sasha show up and see her give Charlotte what she deserves, or part of it, as Fletch put it. And seeing Paige actually stand up next to her, holding the title, as you can see in the picture, and you know, like I said, if we were to actually have a tag match between these girls, you know, I think that would be, you know, I think that should probably be what comes up at the next pay-per-view, would be a tag match with the, with these girls. And, you know, I think it would be awesome to see Paige and Sasha working together and actually getting some retribution on Charlotte and her little cohort that seems to be screwing up more than helping. And, you know, Charlotte actually may have to fight for herself eventually, since she can't seem to get good help. So I'm going to pass it over to you, Florio.
Yeah, I actually agree more with Bullock's rating. We rated it between 1.5 and 2 stars for that effort. I mean, the match was fine up until that ending. And Michael Bullock, and I'm glad you mentioned that little snafu there, Dee Dee Woodson. I'm glad you mentioned that, you know, with the referee staring right at Dana Brooke as Dana Brooke had Charlotte's foot. Bullock and I were both channeling our inner Gorilla Monsoon, saying that should have been an automatic disqualification right there. That's what it should have been. I don't know if he had a, I don't know what the story was with that, but if it was me, I would have done one of two things. I would have either called for a disqualification, or, yeah, inexperienced ref. That's exactly right, Mother Fletcher. Exactly right. I mean, he doesn't have the wisdom of an Earl Hebner or Mike Chioda.
Or eject Dana Brooke.
Yeah, and he didn't eject Dana Brooke. Either eject Dana Brooke or call for the disqualification.
And the referee didn't do either one.
But I think that was a major oopsie. I don't think he was supposed to notice the foot on the rope. I think that was an inexperienced ref not knowing his cue. I hate to say it, and we always talk about how wrestling is definitely real here. I think he made a major oopsie, and I think he's going to get his butt reamed out by Vince McMahon, Kevin Dunn, and the suits. I think that referee might have just done his last match in WWE, sorry to say.
He better get his butt chewed out for it or something, because that was just inexcusable. That was just stupid. Yeah, she got ejected, but she didn't get ejected until, what, about 2 or 3 minutes after he's, you know, saw her holding the foot up there and staring at it. I mean, it's stupid. It, you know, something definitely needs to be done. They either need to train these new refs better or something, because this is just ridiculous.
Yeah, I was going to say, because normally, because I think I've seen that referee before in NXT. Because remember, I do follow NXT a little more deeper than Florio and Bullock does, because I do watch the tape shows on Wednesday nights, and I think I've seen that referee in NXT before. So I think he might have to go back down to NXT and polish himself a little more longer, because that was a blatant oops, and even we were seeing that, and I was like, what the heck? Come on, ref! Really? I mean, I know my boy Tony P or Manny Souza from RWA. They would do a better job than this idiot referee, for God's sakes.
Yeah.
I'll do you one better. I'll do you one better. How about we bring back the ninja referee from American Gladiator season 2? What do you say to that? I think he would be a better official.
Anthony, there's only one problem. The ninja referee only did thumbs up or thumbs down. How the hell is he going to count 1, 2, 3 when the only thing we always saw was either thumbs up or thumbs down? And a lot of times it was always thumbs down.
Or maybe better yet, how about we bring in Larry Thompson? Do you think he'd be capable?
How the hell old is that old nurse, man?
I mean, Derek Ferreira. It'd be great to see him.
How old is him?
I'm not really sure, but I mean, he's got to be up there. I'm sure, probably 80s, but to be real honest, it'd be great to see him. It was always a laugh riot when Derek Ferreira and I would watch the show, and he would always do his ready shtick.
I know. I mean, you could have used the two referees from the Global Gladiators. You could have used the referee from the reboot of American Gladiators. I don't give a damn. You could bring any type of referee. Heck, you could. And I don't want to be too insensitive here, but God rest his soul in heaven. But we could have used Randy Pee-wee Anderson, for heaven's sakes. He would have been a better referee than in the fight tonight.
Or how about if you're gonna go there? What about Joey Morella?
Very true. Like I said, I don't want to be insensitive because two men have passed away, but these guys were top of the line officials.
Yeah,
I mean, hell.
Randy Anderson, absolutely, senior referee in WCW, refereed numerous big fight matches. But if we're gonna go there, how about Nick Patrick? I mean.
Or how about going back in time to when Teddy Long was a referee?
Teddy Long, yeah, that's another great.
I could see him. I could see that. Shane McMahon was a referee, even at one time, when he first started. I mean,
and he set up the ring and everything else before he became what he is now. And I know the Hefners are no longer welcome, but. I mean, Dave Hefner, Earl Hefner.
Well, wait a minute. Why would Dave Hefner not be welcome back? I know Earl's definitely not, but why not?
They were fired.
Oh, wait. Yeah, there was an incident with the Hefners. It was
the merchandise.
The merchandising. Yep, 2005. You're right.
But if we're going to go old school, how about Tommy Young from the old NWA days? I mean... But the point we're trying to make is, I mean, or heck, you could have one of us do it. I mean, one of us would be a more competent official than anything else. So, but the point we're trying to make is, it was a dipsy-doo botcheroo on the part of the ref, and we'll have to wait and see if any course of action ends up being taken. My guess is they'll do what they do best, and that is turn the blind eye, tuck their tail between their legs, so... We'll have to wait and see on that, but you know they're going to turn the blind eye on this. Come on. So, I hope I'm wrong, but we'll see. So, but it's 1.5 to 2 stars for the effort. I mean, the match was fine for what it was. I mean, it was good up until Dana botched the finish. I can't imagine that's how they imagined it going anyways. The Sasha return makes sense, given they need another opponent for Charlotte, while Becky and Natalya have moved on to their own thing. Charlotte and Sasha should be an excellent feud if they get around to it on the main roster. It would get a very interesting split reaction. So that's all there is to say about that. So with all that being said, now we're moving on to a very interesting segment. Phoenix, they're here. The Wyatt family, out of witness protection, are back in the WWE. Bray Wyatt, Eric Rowan, Braun Strowman, of course, Luke Harper, out with that serious injury that he suffered some time ago. So, they're back. Bray Wyatt was doing his usual shtick, the Fireflies and everything else. But, aw, Phoenix, don't you dare be sour. Clap for your world-famous two-time champs. Feel the power. The New Day. Oh, boy. New Day and the Wyatts? What else is there for me to say except I do believe I mean, that segment was all over the place. I've lost my train of thought as to who leads off on it.
I think I do.
Yeah, I thought it was you, Fletcher. Yeah, it is Fletcher. Okay. All right, MF. What do we make of this? The New Day and the Wyatts? What?
Interesting development. I like it. I love it. I can't wait to see more of it. And I hate to be the bearer of bad news, New Day. If this goes down, your reign ends. That 302 days, well now 303 days, comes to a screeching halt. You basically flame out. And the Wyatts will have the whole tag team world in their hands. That's right. Because the Eater of Worlds with the two sheet masks, and yes, I know Florio loves his sheet masks. It doesn't matter if it's white or black or whatever. We're going to have new tag team champions. The Wyatts are going to win the belts. I'm saying it. I'm calling it right now. It is going to be... I love the Wyatts. They are so good. And, you know, he played it. Welcome back. Welcome back. Oh, did you miss me? Yes. Yes, we did. And, you know, maybe we didn't care about Braun Strowman. Maybe we don't care about Luke Harper. Maybe we don't care about Eric Rowan. We sure as hell care about Bray Wyatt. Because Bray Wyatt is one of the most gifted talkers in WWE. And he did it again tonight. The lights were out. The Fireflies were at full force in Phoenix. And the moment was spine-chilling. I was getting goosebumps on my arms, and I was thinking, God, what I would have given to be in that arena when this was going down. And let me tell you guys, I was able to witness it myself, even though it was in the vignette, you know, one of Bray Wyatt's backstage vignettes. I got to see it. Florio got to witness it in all of its glory. The walkout, the whole nine yards. I think Michael Bullock, I don't know if Bullock has ever witnessed the Wyatt family coming out with the Fireflies, and I don't think Dee Dee Woodson has ever experienced it. Not in person yet. Let me tell you, it's an experience above itself. So, yeah. It is definitely one of those things. But I'm shocked. Oh, Brother Bray! Even I was like, what? Are you kidding me? The New Day coming out on this? Yeah, they showed up. They were here. They decided party time. So New Day wants to play a little with the Wyatts. I don't know, man. I don't know. I think this could go down really bad for the New Day. And you're kind of starting to sense that maybe their time is about to run out. Like, it looks like sooner or later it's going to happen to lose these belts. Maybe at Battleground, this might be it. This might be where they finally do drop the belts. Now, if they do survive here, that means it's on upward and onward to SummerSlam and August 21. Do they drop in at Barclays? Very possible. I hate to say it, but you know, there's always that. There's the old term of the sands in the hourglass. Well, that sand is still going, but in my opinion, it's coming to an end. That hourglass, that sand is starting to thin out a little bit, and it's only a matter of time where that last grain will reach the bottom. hate to say it, it's been a great ride for the New Day, but I think the two-time champs is about to become former champions very soon. Dee Dee Woodson, what says you?
For me, I have to say the entrance, just from watching it on TV, is creepy. I can't imagine what it's like in person, you know, but it's, I'm sure it's very, very intense, and, you know, I'd love to actually sit there and experience it one of these days, but for now, you know, watching it on TV is good enough. You know, it was a very well put together segment. I really enjoyed it very much. But somebody, please tell the guy, those three guys, to stop doing the twerking. Ugh, it's getting to where I can lay in bed and actually see them doing it now. I've watched them twerking just so much. It's but enough of that. I think Bray made the perfect point there at the end, though, where he starts laughing at everything New Day has said, and pretty much said that he can see the future of the New Day, and New Day falls and then tells them to run just as the, you know, everything goes black. And, you know, that's definitely pretty much, you know, a normal for the Wyatts to do that. But, you know, you would not have ever expected New Day to come out and confront these guys, and it looks like now we're going to have this building as the next feud for both teams. And, you know, it would be an interesting run, especially if you get all three members of both teams in that ring at the same time. It's going to be a very, very, very good run. But I, you know, definitely I think New Day has bit off more than they can chew with these guys, and we're going to be seeing some solid Wyatt action as they're all coming back. But I am a little curious on their promo that they did earlier in the night. You saw this pregnant woman's belly that they kept writing messages on. So I'm kind of curious how that ties into the Wyatts and their return and what we could be seeing, because there has been rumors that there was going to be an actual person playing Sister Abigail, and one of the rumors that I had heard was it could have been Victoria coming back, but I haven't heard any more on that, so I'm not too sure if we're actually going to see a female Wyatt come out of this or not. But I am, like I said, I'm very curious about this one certain part in their promo there where they were showing this pregnant woman. Are we getting ready to see the birth of something else coming out of the Wyatt family, or is it just there because they are returning? So, you know, there's a lot of questions to go with on that. So, Florio, I'm going to toss it over to you.
Man, oh man, I don't know how to follow that logic of Fletch and Dee Dee. I mean, unreal. But yeah, this is one of my segments of the night for sure. Absolutely. Dee Dee Whitzer, we're going to have to look into your little scenario there. We're definitely going to have to keep a close eye on that. No question about that. I mean, the whole Sister Abigail thing's been long rumored for a long time, so we're going to have to look into that. But I definitely like this dynamic. New Day, against the Wyatts. Fresh feud in the tag team division. I mean, I don't ever recall New Day and the Wyatts having met up before, but great to see the Wyatts back. And I'm going to make a point here. Michael Fletcher, you know, I believe it was last April, went to a SmackDown taping as well, that he went to last year, when he got to see the Firefly entrance. But it was more of a vignette, he said. When I went, you know, when I went 10 months ago, that SmackDown after SummerSlam last year at the Dunkin' Providence, I even posted the video on my Facebook. I mean, it's a sight to behold, and I got to see it with my brother and his friends. We got to see it up close and personal, and we couldn't believe it. We couldn't believe our eyes. I mean, it was just unbelievable, to say the very least. And yeah, what a great experience that was. That was one of the many memories that I took home with me that hot summer night 10 months ago. So, you got to see it to behold. And I hope one day that Michael Bullock and Dee Dee Woodson will get to see it up close and personal. I mean, Raw, like I said, Raw's coming here to the Dunk next month on July 18th, which is the go-home show for Battlegrounds. So I don't know if any tickets are still available or if they're sold out. Derek Ferreira, our executive producer and Hardcore Pipe Bomb, as you know, he got tickets to that show for his birthday, but I'm guessing that's probably going to be with close family, I'm sure. I mean, I wish he would take us with him, make it a true wrestling forum, but, you know, it is what it is on that. But nonetheless, very good segment for what it was. Another one of the segments of the night, and a fresh feud in the tag division. There's still a part of me that thinks New Day is going to... We always keep asking the million-dollar question, when are New Day going to finally drop the tag team belts? My guess is SummerSlam. That's just my guess, because they won it last year at SummerSlam. I wouldn't be surprised if they have them hold on to it until SummerSlam in Brooklyn. Who takes it off them? Well, who knows at this point? There have been so many teams we thought was going to take it off of them, but from the Dudleys to the Vaudevillains, Enzo and Cass, Gallows and Anderson, but they're still trucking along, those New Day. They're still your WWE World Tag Team Champions. So that's it. So with that being said, one of the segments of the night for sure. Great to see the Wyatts back. We missed them. Michael Bullock, if you're with us, what do you say about it? Bullock, you with us? Yeah, I had a feeling. All right. We're not gonna wait. We're just gonna move on. All right, let's see. What happened was, it was almost like a carbon copy of last week. I mean, we had Rusev, the United States Heavyweight Champion, with Lana, you know, and then Titus O'Neil comes out. It was supposed to be Rusev against Titus O'Neil in a match, a non-title match that Titus O'Neil requested and was granted. And then what happens is these two end up going at it. I mean, we're obviously going to consider this an NA, but I want to get some quick thoughts from Michael Fletcher and Dee Dee Woodson as far as this is concerned. I mean, Titus showed very good fire. I mean, honestly, I didn't really care to see more of this feud coming out of the pay-per-view, but I thought they breathed some life into it during this segment. Fletch, Dee Dee, I'm going to call an open forum here. Whoever wants to, you know, chime in about this, because this was really not a match. This was more of an angle than anything else.
This was a brawl. This was a straight-up brawl. This was get the hell out of the way. Get, you know, you assaulted my mama. You son of a you-know-what. You dissed my family last night. I'm putting a foot in your ass. That's what that was. Titus O'Neil got pissed off. He went off because of the fact that Rusev disrespected his two sons by saying that his daddy was a loser. And happy Father's Day last night after he successfully defended the United States Heavyweight Championship. And you don't think for one Colin Pickin second that Titus O'Neil was not going to respond to that? Oh, hell no. That's disrespectful. You say something bad about my family, man, you are about to get your
butt kicked in this situation. That's a warning to anybody. You say junk about my family, that is it. I am going off. It's Cerebral Viper time. Titus O'Neil went off. He tried to get some of Rusev. He was not done getting, and he was going to make sure he won't get every last lick on him before either the referees or somebody pulled him off, because he went nuts. And that's a good angry Titus O'Neil. That actually got me rejuvenated. I'm like, holy crap, man, why didn't we see this last night at Money in the Bank? You know, good grief. But, you know, I liked it. That's what you expected. You know, Rusev shot his mouth off. Somebody was going to get – it was going to get back to Titus one way or another. It did, and he made him pay in spades. Didi, it's yours.
You make it personal, you're going to get what's coming to you. And as a parent, you know, I have to honestly say I would be the exact same way. You say something about my kids, especially the fact that I have some special needs kids, and don't ever say the R word or type the R word anywhere near me, or I'm going to explode. And I have a feeling Bullock would do the same thing if someone was to come up and call somebody a retard, because that is, I mean, that's about as derogatory as going up to a African American and calling them the N-word. You know, it's very derogatory, especially to people with special needs, people who have those kind of issues that are very uncontrollable, that they didn't ask for, that it just happened. And as a parent, you know, you come and you get in my kid's face like Rusev did Titus's kids and start talking down their dad, yeah, you're going to get that fury of a parent. And, you know, that wasn't fake. That was real. That was a parent lashing out, trying to protect what's his, what his, you know, his family, his little inner circle. And, you know, I've done it several times where I've gotten in people's faces and said, hey, look. In fact, I did it once to Kevin and a friend of mine, because they were starting to argue in front of my kids, and I'm saying, hey, look, no, you know, not even my own husband is going to sit here and argue with somebody else in front of the kids that don't need to be sitting here watching this. So, yeah, I mean, that's just something that any parent, I think, would do. And, you know, I definitely give a lot of respect to Titus on that, because, you know, pretty much Rusev admitted he didn't care before Titus even came out. He didn't care about how his actions affected Titus or affected the family. And, you know, Dad had to come in. Dad had to clean house, and he definitely cleaned house, and he definitely made a statement that is going to probably have even more ramifications. And if this feud continues, all I know is he made his point tonight. The exclamation point was put on it, and there's not much more you can say about it other than, you know, you can't take down a scorned parent. And when that animal instinct comes out to protect your family, you have to let it out, and nothing and no one is going to stop it. And, you know, I think that's exactly what we saw tonight. So I'm going to toss it back to you, Florio.
Yeah, I mean, great points again, guys. I mean, what else is there to say? I mean, it was a brawl, it was a battle. I mean, I thought this feud was a one-time deal, but I guess apparently they're going to continue it. And I wouldn't be surprised if we end up getting this again at Battlegrounds, so we'll have to wait and see how that goes. So, yeah, I mean, boy, howdy did that get intense. I'll tell you that right now. So, while we wait for Bullet to come back, let's just move on to, let me see. And there was some more stuff with Shane McMahon, you know, talking about Chris Jericho and everything else, and then they hyped that Seth Rollins will be in action on SmackDown, so that should be interesting. And now we move on to our main event, the number one contenders match, Roman Reigns, Seth Rollins. It ends in a double countout in 16 minutes and 35 seconds. We have a double countout, so we think, okay, what happens now? Shane McMahon comes down and makes the announcement. I initially thought we were going to get this at SummerSlam, but it's going to actually go down a month earlier at Battleground. Shield triple threat match for the WWE World Heavyweight Championship. Dean Ambrose, Seth Rollins, Roman Reigns. I believe since Bullock is out, I believe Fletcher starts this off, if I'm correct. So, all right, Michael Fletcher, your thoughts on the match, as well as the inevitable announcement by Shane O'Mac, Battleground, Shield, Triple Threat.
Fight of the night, I kind of felt like we knew this was going to happen. It's a 3.5-star fight. First off, I'm just going to let that get out of the way. 3.5-star fight. This was an amazing main event. This was a great way to close Monday Night Raw. Like we said, I kind of feel like it was understandable. I don't think none of us is going to jump off the bridge or yell or say, oh, what the heck, because either it was going to be a DQ finish or it was going to be a count out. We knew that. So I'm not going to make a big hoopla over that. That's not going to be the big thing. But what did make interesting was that we are getting Roman Reigns, Dean Ambrose, and Seth Rollins. Your main event that was supposed to be for SummerSlam, we're getting it 1 month early, which is a big deal. That's a huge deal for all of us. Because now, what does that mean? You know, what type of ramifications is that going to have on the WWE World Heavyweight Championship? Because of the fact that this fight is now completely set, and Shane even made it very clear, we don't know what's going to happen after this draft. You know, a couple of these guys could be on their way to different shows. So it looks like WWE had to go all in on this fight, even though I know the fans would have been very excited for a Shield triple threat fight at SummerSlam for this, but unfortunately, with the draft now on July 19th, it kind of had to speed the timeline up. So it didn't matter at this point in the game what happens. It's a now or never move. It's either we get this fight now or this will not happen after the fact, because like I said, with all the rumors circulating around who's going to Raw, who's going to SmackDown, there's a very good chance one or even two of these former Shield members is going to be a split. They're going to get broken apart. So the odds of seeing all three guys together on one show, I'm going to say it, slim to none is my prediction. I think Roman or Ambrose is heading to SmackDown, and you'll get two of them, but I don't think you're going to get all three staying in one show together. I just don't see it. I don't see it at all. So what happens now? Where do we go? Well, we had to do this. I'll tell you one thing for sure. You know who the real winners are? The fans of Washington, D.C., I mean, our nation's capital, holy cow, man. Verizon Center in Washington, what was originally known as the MCI Center in Washington, they just hit the lottery. They just hit the jackpot, man. We talk about rolling the dice and playing in Las Vegas last night at T-Mobile. Now the Verizon Center in D.C. just hit the lottery because they now have the Shield triple threat for the WWE World Heavyweight title. It don't get no bigger than this, guys. So, 3.5 stars, fight of the night. We kind of expected a clunky finish, but I think the result of us getting the triple threat now, before SummerSlam, is actually better. And I kind of need to say the reason why this is happening is because of the draft. Because if it wasn't for the draft, I think they would have pushed this back to SummerSlam. Just my personal opinions. Woodson, it's yours.
I totally agree with the rating and the fact that this is the fight of the night. These two guys, you know, they gave you almost the same quality of a match as you got last night. They, you know, they just took it to each other, and then having Ambrose right there at ringside at the announce table, of course, right next to his biggest fan, JBL, you know, it made it really that much more of an enjoyable match because, you know, the commentary that you got from Ambrose, it just, you know, it was just the icing on top. You know, if this was like a building a sundae, you know, Ambrose being there, you know, you just put the icing on it, and then having Shane come out and say, "We're now going to have a triple threat." There's your cherry. There is, you know, you just basically got the best of the best, and it was definitely the best way to end this show. And the, you know, there's just no words to say how you, you know, it just, I don't know, I'm losing my train of thought. I think it's because it's 1:30 in the morning almost, but, you know, it's just one of those matches that you don't want to forget it, because it's going to linger. And the, you know, this feud of the three Shield members, you know, I can see it going on longer. But of course, with the draft coming up on the 19th and pretty much taking up the whole first hour, you know, it's going to be interesting to see if, you know, Dean and Roman end up on one show, or Roman and Seth end up on one show, or Dean and Seth, or how, you know, whatever. It's going to be interesting to see how this lies out, because you know there has to be at least two of them on one show. And, you know, we also don't know what the situation is with the champions. At least I haven't heard anything on it. I don't know about you guys, but, you know, if Dean still has the title, he could be going back and forth from show to show also. So, you know, that could also be another factor in this whole thing too, to also possibly continue a feud with this former stable, former brotherhood. And it's going to be interesting. It's going to be one of these, you know, matches that you're going to hope that it's going to be at the same quality as it was for this last pay-per-view. So I'm going to toss it over to you, Florio.
Unanimous fight of the night, no question about it, despite the double count-out finish. 3.5 stars. Yeah, the finish was disappointing in many of our eyes, but that was quickly washed away when Shane O'Mac made the official announcement, the inevitable announcement, that we were going to get the Shield triple threat at Battleground for the title. I mean, I initially thought SummerSlam was the possible date, but I guess the draft, I guess it does make sense when you really think about it, to move it up, to have it a month earlier than initially I thought. I mean, I thought the big money match was this for SummerSlam, but I guess maybe they have other plans. We'll have to wait and see what the plan is for the World Heavyweight Championship come August 21st in Brooklyn. But like Michael Fletcher said, the real winners are the fans in Washington, D.C. I mean, they're going to get to see the most anticipated World Heavyweight Championship match in recent memory. I mean, it's going to rank up there. I mean, this is going to go down as the most anticipated championship triple threat match since WrestleMania 20, for goodness sakes, when Triple H, Shawn Michaels, and Chris Benoit, we all remember that. All right, Dee Dee Woodson, that's fair enough. So I'm just going to wrap it up here. When I say that it's 3.5 stars, it's the fight of the night. I hated the double count out finish, but I'm like, why else would they have Rollins and Reigns go at it for a contenders match? I mean, the only way we're gonna get a triple threat is if they had a clunky finish, and then once the clunky finish went down, like, yeah, we're gonna get the Shield triple threat. So that's it for that. So with that, it's overall review time, and I'm gonna have Dee Dee Woodson start it off because I know she has to get going. So, all right, Dee Dee Woodson, I'm not gonna keep you much longer. Just give us your quick overall thought on this Raw tonight, and then we'll let you go.
For me, I guess I would give it probably a 6 to 6.5 stars for the whole show, because, you know, you did have some really good segments, and like I said at the beginning of the show, the segments was definitely better than most of the matches. But you also had some pretty lousy matches that was in there that, you know, just kind of made it a ho-hum type show. But I think what made it the best, or made it, you know, really good there, was the ending really just kind of turned the show around, keeping it from being, you know, one of these shows that we'd sit here and gripe the whole thing through. So, for me, I'll give it the 6.5, and I will see you guys next week.
Fair enough, Dee Dee Woodson. We'll see you next week. Best of luck to you on your interview tomorrow. So we'll let you go, and we'll just see you next week. So so I'll take it from here. I sort of agree with Dee Dee Woodson. About 6 to 6.5 out of 10. I mean, it's mainly because of the body of work of the in-ring segments, as well as you had a couple of standout matches. I mean, the main event, obviously. Second best fight of the night, I'd have to say, was Sami Zayn and Kevin Owens. And the other matches were just there. But the in-ring segments, mainly the body of work of those in-ring segments, and a couple of newsworthy items that went down. So yeah, I think 6 to 6.5 is the appropriate rating for this show tonight. I mean, not as good as what we saw last night, but there was definitely another element of Shakespearean drama, especially with the world title picture. Shield triple threat, I can't say that enough. We're getting it. Initially, I thought, like I said, I initially thought SummerSlam, but Battleground, I mean, hey, no better way to put butts in the seats in Washington, D.C., as well as eyes on the screens of WWE Network subscribers and those souls that actually still buy the traditional pay-per-views that shell away $55. So that's all there is to say on that. So 6, 6.5 out of 10. I agree with Dee Dee Woodson's rating. Michael Fletcher, do you agree with that rating? Do you have it higher, lower? How do you feel about this show?
No, I have it about 6. I think it was a good show. I mean, it looked pretty solid for the most part. I really got nothing bad to say about it. Yeah, I mean, could some of the moments been a little better? Absolutely. But, you know, it is what it is. I don't think there was really much on the way of it. And, you know, hopefully they'll do good next week. You know, there's definitely some, you know, you definitely got 2 good fights already announced. They did confirm, you know, we got our first official match confirmed for the title, which is going to be Roman Reigns, Dean Ambrose, and Seth Rollins for the WWE World Heavyweight Championship. And we're all assuming, or we're all going to guess, that we're going to get Sasha versus Charlotte for the women's title, and maybe the Wyatt family versus the New Day for the WWE Tag Team Championship. So already you're starting to see the planting of seeds already in some of the matches, and AJ Styles versus John Cena too, and who knows, maybe Rusev and Titus O'Neil, a rematch for the United States Heavyweight Championship. So right there, how I reeled off what, like 5 matches already for the card. So I mean, yeah, definitely a great start to work with. We'll see what happens. So, with that said, Anthony, if it's all right, I would like to start with my Mikey's Mindset, because I only got very little docket here tonight, so...
Yeah, by all means, go ahead.
Okay. All right, so the Mikey's Mindset, pretty much, the Lucha Underground, there's only one fight. It was the 6th to survive. It's basically an elimination match. 6 people were in it. The 6 participants, just to give you a heads up, we had was Phoenix, Eva Lise, Johnny Mundo, King Cuerno, Daya, and Pentagon Jr. Now, the way the fight was basically, it goes down, is it's an elimination match. Basically, when you pinfall or submitted, you're out of the fight. And basically, last person standing wins the match, becomes the number one contender for the Lucha Underground world title. The when it was all said and done, in 52 minutes and 49 seconds, this fight took. The winner of the bout and the number one contender for the Lucha Underground Championship is Pentagon Jr. He's going to fight Matanza Cuerto in the main event of Lucha Underground's Ultima Lucha 2, and that is going down in a couple of weeks. As a matter of fact, it's going to come down actually in the next couple of weeks. The show itself was a 9 out of 10. The fight itself, I could give this about 4.25 to 4.5 stars. I thought this was an amazing fight. All right, so now for Ring of Honor, we had Dalton Castle going up against Grotto, who actually represents the member of one of my favorite crew, Chaos. Dalton Castle won. Then we had Tom Harisho Ishii going one-on-one against Will Ferrara, and Ishii wins the match there. And our main event we actually had was the Influence of Gorillas, and the Young Bucks. They went up against, listen to this team, the Briscoes, the Roderick Strong, and the reigning, defending, undisputed Ring of Honor World Heavyweight Champion, Jay Lethal, of course, accompanied by Taylor Hendricks. And the winner of the bout was Team ROH. They won the match where it was Jay Lethal getting the pin on one of the Young Bucks to win the match. Just a one fall to the finish, 8-man tag team fight. So overall, that was definitely a great, you know, good show, solid show. I liked it. I got nothing bad to say about that. And then as far as, like I said, unfortunately, no RWA news this week. Sorry to say. I mean, you know, it stinks, but, you know, RWA has a big show coming up in July, and, you know, when I hear more information, I'll definitely give you it. Hopefully we'll get something starting maybe next week. We'll see. But until then, this was the Mikey's Mindset. Like I said, very short tonight. Anthony, it's yours.
Yes, and now we follow up the Mikey's Mindset with the Tony's Take, and we're going to start off like we always do with Impact Wrestling. And Michael Fletcher, I gotta ask you, did you try watching the show last week? I'm sure you did. I'm sure you endured all that nonsense beforehand.
Well, I was working during, and I'm thinking, ah, great, you know, we're not, you know, if I miss it, I miss it. But then I was pleasantly surprised watching the show, and it was about, what, 11 at night going into 12 in the morning, and I'm like, what the hell is going on? And the next thing I hear, Ferrer on his Facebook saying, oh, God, this is one of the longest nights we've ever had, and this and that. So I'm like, oh, what the hell happened? Well, it looks like Pop TV was acting like a noggin a diva. What the hell?
Well, here's what happened. If for any of you who may not have saw it, you know it starts at 9 o'clock. I mean, we all know. I mean that Impact Wrestling starts Tuesday nights 9 o'clock on the button and whatnot. And what happened was, for almost 2 hours, they had a major technical difficulty. They were showing all these commercials or promos for shows they are on their network. Of course, they have the game, the new hit game show, Celebrity Name Game, which, of course, as we all know, hosted by Craig Ferguson. Fun show. I admit, one of my favorite game shows. I watch it regularly. It's a great show. They air it at 6 o'clock. And they actually showed some promos for Impact Wrestling. And the other show that they showed was a personal favorite of myself and Michael Fletcher when we used to grow up back in the day. That 70s show? Yeah, we had a lot of fun with that show, boy. I'll tell you that right now. I remember when we used to call each other up and we used to, you know, talk about the show and watch the show and, you know, get some laughs out of that sucker, believe me. But they were showing these promos basically in a row for almost damn near 2 hours. Yeah, they had some shots from Impact Wrestling in there, but apparently there was some bad weather. Pop TV's based out of Atlanta, Georgia, and they had some very bad weather in the area. I think rainy, thunderstormy type weather, and it messed up the feed. And I don't believe the Impact feed didn't really fully come in until about 10 of 11, right around 10:50 or so. And that's when we finally got the action going. After nearly 2 hours worth of looped commercials of that 70s show, Celebrity Name Game, and even Impact Wrestling, we finally got down to the show, and it starts off with the brand new TNA World Heavyweight Champion Bobby Lashley, and he cut a promo, and you know he was doing his usual promo, and then he was interrupted by Ethan Carter III. And then interrupted by former champion Drew Galloway, and then they had a segment, and there's nothing left for me to say except this was the segment of the night. I mean, I thought this was a phenomenal segment. I mean, all three guys were great. Lashley was great. EC3 was great as always. Galloway was great, and you know, Galloway and Lashley making their cases for a rematch, of course. Galloway has more of a case because he's the former champion, automatic rematch clause, but EC3 wants in the title picture too. So, but nonetheless, this was a phenomenal, phenomenal segment. So, far and away the segment of the night. Next up, we had our first match of the evening, King of the Mountain Championship match, champion Eli Drake defending against the charismatic enigma, Jeff Hardy. And you're thinking, okay, is this going to be a Jeff Hardy-Barry job? No. Hardy wins the match, but it was via disqualification because of Matt Hardy. Matt Hardy interfered. Fine match for what it was. I'm going to give it about 2.5 stars for the effort. I mean, it was an okay fight. I mean, there was some good action in there. And belt that nobody cares about, according to Jason Powell. And, you know, some may not have cared for the match on paper, but after seeing it play out, I came away feeling like the best way to elevate Drake is to have him work with bigger names. And it doesn't get any bigger than Jeff Hardy. So, yeah, 2.5 stars is how I feel about it. And then following that, you know, the Hardys had another verbal exchange, and we'll have more on that in a little bit. And then Then we had another championship. This was the Gold Rush show, by the way. This was the Gold Rush show. All the men's titles were on the line. The women's title was not on the line. Rematch for the X Division Championship. New champion Eddie Edwards against former champion Trevor Lee with Gregory Shane Helms. Winner of the match in 4 minutes and still X Division champion. It is Eddie Edwards. Disappointing match. Only one star. I can only give it one star for the effort. I mean, disappointing match. It was only 4 minutes and it did nothing to protect Trevor Lee. Even if TNA officials don't see much in Lee for some odd reason, it's not like they have a deep roster of X Division wrestlers. In other words, they should be getting as much out of this program as possible. So, yeah, I'm not even going to get any more into that. So, it's not often I bring Michael Fletcher in during this segment, but I want to bring him in on this because of what the next segment was. I want to get a brief thought from him on this. They announced the newest inductee into the TNA Wrestling Hall of Fame. And I know, much to the delight of Michael Fletcher and myself, for the first time since the TNA Hall of Fame officially opened, we have ourselves our first female inductee. And I couldn't think of a better name for that to be than the pioneer of the Knockouts division and the first ever Knockouts champion and the longest running Knockouts champion of all time, the one and only Gail Kim. MF, I know you be, I mean, I'm a fan of hers too, don't get me wrong. I love her work and I love her look and everything else, but you've been a fan of her since day one when she walked in to the WWE back in 2003 when they had all those vignettes. You even fell in love with her during those vignettes when you and I used to, you know, call each other on the phone and watch Raw, you know, back in the summertime, back in those days. I mean, I remember how excited you were and how giddy you were when we saw the vignettes, and then when she finally debuted. I mean, I know your jaw hit the floor because of how stunning and beautiful she is, and she is. So, but I know nobody could be more delighted about this induction than you, Michael Fletcher, and that's why, I mean, I know we usually don't intrude on each other's segments, but I really do want to get your thoughts of, your brief thoughts about Gail Kim, the first female inductee into the TNA Hall of Fame and a personal favorite of yours.
I'll make it very brief and I'll leave it at that. Well deserved honor. I mean, she's paved the way, like you said. She's done so much for TNA and just in wrestling in general. It's a darn shame it didn't work out for her in WWE. But one person's trash is another person's treasure, and she has been a treasure to TNA, and I think Dixie Carter and the company themselves did the right thing by getting Gail Kim as their newest inductee to the Hall of Fame, and it's worthy. It's a worthy moment. It's a perfect thing. I have nothing bad to say about it. I mean, you know, she's done so much for this company, and we've said it many times before. You know, she was a part of the Jeff Jarrett stable at the very beginning, but she really made her name as a female wrestler, the first ever Knockouts champion in the history of the company, and she wore that belt with pride and with honor to be the flag bearer, and she still is a flag bearer for the Knockouts division. You know, regardless of who's still in the division, who's not in the division anymore, there has always been that thing about people looking up to Gail and respecting Gail and loving the body of work, and she's worked so hard in the business and to make it to where she is today as one of the top female wrestlers. I mean, there's a lot of people that really loves her, and you know, there was a lot of sacrifices she had to make in her career. You know, she did take a chance to go back to WWE, and she didn't have fun there. She didn't have the enjoyment or anything like it, and decided to go back to TNA. You know, obviously it ended up being a smart move for her to go back to TNA and to continue the path that she has gone on, and lo and behold, now we can say she is a Hall of Famer. There's really nothing else to say. Yes, I adore the girl very much. I fell in love with her almost instantly when she first debuted in WWE. Yes, the vignettes had me intrigued a little bit about the mystery of her. Didn't know much about her, but trust me, when she made her debut and won the World Wrestling Federation Women's Championship, literally the very first night, I was floored. Didn't know what to expect, what to see, but each and every week, it didn't matter if she was a face or a heel, I was developing a love affair with this girl, and I respected the body of work, what she brought to the table, and it has grown and has always continued. I know a lot of fellas were really ticked off when they found out that she got married, but hey, it is what it is. But, you know, all I can say is that she has continued to pave the way and be, you know, a beacon for the women's division and to be recognized, you know, even from not only us, but even from a lot of the wrestling insiders, you know, like Dave Meltzer, from like all the other guys that we normally listen to, 411 Mania, Wrestling News World, the wrestling newsletter and the whole nine yards, ProWrestling.net, calling Gail probably one of the best female wrestlers of our generation, and she is. She is an actual pure wrestler. And go figure, man, from Toronto, Ontario, Canada, too. And that's one thing everybody really knows. She was originally from Canada. So, I mean, there's nothing more to say. She has really paved the way, and this was definitely a well-deserved honor. And congratulations to the beautiful Gail Kim, Hall of Famer, TNA, Class of 2016.
Yeah. Through Facebook messaging, we got Michael Bullock back. We'll get his remaining thoughts on Raw as soon as I wrap up with this Tony's Take segment. I'll try not to be too long. So, but yeah, congratulations indeed to Gail Kim, the newest inductee into the TNA Wrestling Hall of Fame and the very first female inductee into the TNA Wrestling Hall of Fame. She will be officially enshrined at TNA's version of WrestleMania, which, as we all know, is Bound for Glory. That will be in October. So definitely looking forward to that. Well-deserved. She's done everything, you know, Knockouts champion, first ever. She holds the record for longest reign. Of course, had that awesome rivalry with Kong. I mean, who'll ever forget that? The greatest rivalry in Knockouts history. Nothing will ever compare to that. So yeah. So with that being said, let's move on to our next match. You know, they have backstage the little interview segment with Marty Bell and Jade. And then we had ourselves a four-way match for the TNA World Tag Team Championships, The Decay against Grado and Mahavali Shira, The Tribunal, and The Bromans. Winners of the match, and still TNA World Tag Team Champions, it was The Decay. About 2 stars, I would have to say, for the effort. I mean, it was fine for what it was, but yeah, I mean, foregone conclusion, we already know that, so on. And then after that, we had an in-ring segment with Maria Kanellis and Mike Bennett, interrupted by Billy Corgan and Dixie Carter. Wow. This was another great segment. I mean, this was the second best segment of the night. I only thought the three segment was better, the EC3, Drew Galloway, Bobby Lashley segment, but this was great as well. I mean, and then we have an angle, though. Dixie Carter put her hands on Maria. She slapped her. And, well, needless to say, there's going to be definitely a lot of there's going to be a major development coming up on the next show, which I'm going to get into in a little bit. So, very good segment, though. And then the main event, TNA World Heavyweight Championship, Bobby Lashley in a rematch from Slammiversary against Drew Galloway. Winner of the match, and still TNA World Heavyweight Champion, it is Bobby Lashley. Fight of the night, 3 to 3.25 stars. Very good main event. I mean, these two have worked so well together. I mean, the Slammiversary match was out of this world. I mean, this was just as good, but I thought the Slammiversary match was better. So with that, overall, very good show. Solid show. I would have to probably say 6 out of 10 at best. I mean, the World Heavyweight Championship was clearly the fight of the night. A couple of great in-ring segments and everything else. I mean, it was a long night with nearly 2 hours of technical difficulties, and they actually aired it nearly commercial-free once it got going. And main event was great. Mike Bennett and Maria's segment was very good, and I mean, I don't know what else there is to say about it, so 6 out of 10 for me on that. What's going to happen on the next show, which is tonight, and hopefully it all goes according to plan. Hopefully there will be no difficulties this time. You're going to get the in-ring segment with Maria Kanellis and Mike Bennett, along with Billy Corgan, and we'll see what happens with that situation with Dixie Carter. Mike Bennett has a Feast or Fire X Division title briefcase. He announced his intention to cash in, and that's exactly what he does. So Mike Bennett will face Eddie Edwards for the X Division Championship. Knockouts match, Marty Bell versus Jade, former Dollhouse partners going at it. The Decay, two-on-one handicap match against Bram. They tried to recruit Bram, but Bram said no, and that led into a handicap match. There was a segment with Bobby Lashley, Drew Galloway, and EC3, and Lashley actually plays authority figure, and Lashley says, okay, we're going to have a tag team match. Me and Eli Drake, the King of the Mountain champion, against the two of you, Drew Galloway and EC3. And if you two win, the two of you win, I'll give you title shots. So it leads to the tag team match. Ethan Carter III and Drew Galloway going up against King of the Mountain champion Eli Drake and the World Heavyweight champion Bobby Lashley. EC3 and Galloway win. They get title shots. Simple as that. And then in the main event, 6 sides of steel cage match. Jeff Hardy, Matt Hardy, what else is there to say? Impact Wrestling tonight, 9 Eastern, Pop Television. Please don't let there be 2 hours worth of technical difficulty, because I swear if I see any of those commercials in a loop again, I swear I'm going to pull my damn hair out. So, and I'll pull it out by the roots, believe me. So that was beyond unbearable a week ago, let me be real honest with you. So that's that. SmackDown, I'm going to get into a brief review of the SmackDown because I don't want to take up too much time because we all have things to do. So it's been a long night mainly because of that news and views segment, but we had to get into that. SmackDown, Biloxi, Mississippi, Mississippi Coast Coliseum. We had the Money in the Bank participants basically in the ring. Chris Jericho was basically like a highlight reel. Jericho was in there, Dean Ambrose, Sami Zayn, Kevin Owens, and very good opening segment. Far and away the segment of the night. I mean, I don't know what else there was to say. I mean, most entertaining opening segment in weeks, mostly thanks to that coffee bit that got the crowd involved early in the quick transitions. Didn't count on two guys to carry a 20-minute verbal segment, and it was better off for it. 4-way match, big cast, Kofi Kingston, Aiden English, Luke Gallows. Winner of the match, Kofi Kingston. It was an okay fight, about 2 stars worth. Just never caught fire for me. It wasn't bad, but not great either. Never really felt dramatic, even down the stretch when they were working towards the finish. Don't really blame anyone. They cut to a commercial at the wrong time, and there wasn't much suspense built. So, Baron Corbin against Zack Ryder. Baron Corbin won that. Absolute dud. Worst fight of the night. I'm not even going to waste any time. And there was some backstage stuff. And then we had Xavier Woods going up against AJ Styles. AJ Styles won the match with a phenomenal forearm and the calf killer. One of the fights of the night. I would have to say, I mean, it's a toss-up between fight of the night and second best fight of the night. But it was definitely 3 to 3.5 stars. Enjoyable match. Woods looked very good and got in a lot of offense. And a near fall that won over quite a few in the crowd. Styles is having great matches with everybody on this card. And don't know if it'll lead to a singles breakout for Woods come the draft, but he might be tasked with more of it with the brand split. Natalya against Charlotte. Charlotte won the match. Somewhat of a disappointing match. Another two-star effort. So I'm just going to leave it at that. And then the main event, Chris Jericho and Kevin Owens against Alberto Del Rio. Well, actually, it was a six-man tag, sorry. Chris Jericho, Kevin Owens, Alberto Del Rio, Dean Ambrose, Sami Zayn, and Cesaro. Ambrose, Zayn, and Cesaro win it. Second best fight of the night. Solid 3 stars. It placed a lot of focus on the Money in the Bank match, but didn't add much gas to the fire. And it followed the conventions they had already set for the feud and continued to tease Dean Ambrose potentially cashing in. Overall, entertaining show, but mediocre as a go-home show. 6.5 to 7 out of 10. Only person that made me interested in seeing his match more was AJ Styles. But, you know, it was a solid show, so not mind-blowing. So, and on the next show, Seth Rollins is going to be in action, I guess. So that's all I know. So with that, before we wrap it up, I want to quickly bring Michael Bullock back in. He's back in. So Bullock, I'm just going to have you give your brief thoughts on the rest of Monday Night Raw from where you left off. I don't remember where you left off, but we're going to have you give you your brief overall thoughts on this show tonight before we wrap up this long night. So Bullock, it's all yours. Bullock, you back in? I thought you were back in. All right. I guess not. So I guess what we're going to do is we're just going to wrap up the show. You know what? It's been a long night. I'm just going to – I know we usually do our shout-outs, but I'm just going to move on from it. We'll save those for Friday night. It's our usual shout-outs anyway, so I don't want to keep these guys any longer. We've had a long enough night as it is. So we're going to put the bow on this edition of the Wrestling Forum. We want to thank you all so very much for tuning in. And Friday night, we're going to talk about the Cleveland Cavaliers winning the NBA championship, Strictly Sports, as well as our complete recap of the NBA draft, team by team, with grades. So no Major League Baseball power rankings. And that's it. So 10:30 Friday night. So until then, you've been watching the Wrestling Forum right here on Atone25 on YouTube.com. Ridiculously Over Anthony Flair here for the Cerebral Viper Michael Fletcher, the Phenom Michael Bullock in its spirit, Twisted Angel D.D. Woodson and the Hardcore Pipe, I'm Derek Ferreira. You know the routine, everybody. Thumbs up. Talk to you later. Yeah, throw it up Fortune 4 style. Bye for now, my friends. God bless. Be good to each other. So long. And remember, no matter what anyone tells you, wrestling is indeed actually real. Good night, everybody, and we'll see you Friday night for Strictly Sports.